This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to find out how you can volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by John Nicholson. Allan Quatermain by H. Rider Haggard. I inscribe this book of adventure to my son, Arthur John Rider Haggard, in the hope that in days to come he, and many other boys, whom I shall never know, may, in the acts and thoughts of Allan Quatermain and his companions, as recorded herein, find something to help him and them to reach to what, with Sir Henry Curtis, I hold to be the highest rank whereto we can attain, the state and dignity of English gentlemen. Introduction. December 23rd. I have just buried my boy, my poor handsome boy, of whom I was so proud, and my heart is broken. It is very hard, having only one son, to lose him thus, but God's will be done. Who am I that I should complain? The great wheel of fate rolls on like a juggernaut and crushes us all in turn, some soon, some late. It does not matter when. In the end, it crushes us all. We do not prostrate ourselves before it like the poor Indians. We fly hither and thither. We cry for mercy. But it is of no use. The black fate thunders on, and in its season reduces us to powder. Poor Harry, to go so soon, just when his life was opening to him. He was doing so well at the hospital. He had passed his last examination with honors, and I was proud of them, much prouder than he was, I think. And then he must needs go to that smallpox hospital. He wrote to me that he was not afraid of smallpox and wanted to gain the experience. And now the disease has killed him, and I, old and gray and withered, am left to mourn over him without a chick or child to comfort me. I might have saved him, too. I have money enough for both of us, and much more than enough. King Solomon's mines provided me with that. But I said, no, let the boy earn his living, let him labor, that he may enjoy rest. But the rest has come to him before the labor. Oh, my boy, my boy. I am like the man in the Bible, who laid up much goods and builded barns, goods for my boy and barns for him to store them in. And now his soul has been required of him, and I am left desolate. I would that it had been my soul and not my boy's. We buried him this afternoon under the shadow of the gray and ancient tower of the church of this village where my house is. It was a dreary December afternoon, and the sky was heavy with snow, but not much was falling. The coffin was put down by the grave, and a few big flakes lit upon it. They looked very white upon the black cloth. There was a little hitch about getting the coffin down into the grave. The necessary ropes had been forgotten. So we drew back from it and waited in silence, watching the big flakes fall gently one by one like heavenly benedictions, and melt in tears on Harry's pall. But that was not all. A robin redbreast came as bold as could be, and lit upon the coffin and began to sing. And then I am afraid that I broke down, and so did Sir Henry Curtis, strong man though he is. And as for Captain Good, I saw him turn away too. Even in my own distress, I could not help noticing it. The above, signed Allan Quatermain, is an extract from my diary, written 2 years and more ago, I copy it down here because it seems to me that it is the fittest beginning to the history that I am about to write, if it please God to spare me to finish it. If not, well, it does not matter. That extract was penned 7,000 miles or so from the spot where I now lie painfully and slowly writing this, with a pretty girl standing by my side, fanning the flies from my august countenance. Harry is there, and I am here, and yet somehow I cannot help feeling that I am not far off Harry. When I was in England, I used to live in a very fine house. At least I call it a fine house, speaking comparatively, and judging from the standard of the houses I have been accustomed to all my life in Africa. Not 500 yards from the old church where Harry is asleep, and thither I went after the funeral and ate some food, for it is no good starving even if one has just buried all one's earthly hopes. But I could not eat much, and soon I took to walking, or rather limping, being permanently lame from the bite of a lion, up and down the oak-paneled vestibule, for there is a vestibule in my house in England. On all the four walls of this vestibule were placed pairs of horns, about 100 pairs altogether, all of which I had shot myself. They are beautiful specimens, as I never keep any horns which are not in every way perfect, unless it may be now and again on account of the associations connected with them. In the center of the room, however, over the wide fireplace, there was a clear space left on which I had fixed up all my rifles. Some of them I have had for 40 years, old muzzle loaders that nobody would look at nowadays. One was an elephant gun with strips of rimpi, or green hide, lashed round the stock and locks, such as used to be owned by the Dutchmen, Aurora they called it. That gun, the Boer I bought it from many years ago told me, had been used by his father at the Battle of the Blood River, just after Dingaan swept into Natal and slaughtered 600 men, women, and children, so that the Boers named the place where they died Weenun, or the Place of Weeping, and so it is called to this day, and always will be called. And many an elephant have I shot with that old gun. She always took a handful of black powder and a 3-ounce ball, and kicked like the very deuce. Well, up and down I walked, staring at the guns and the horns which the guns had brought low. And as I did so, there rose up in me a great craving. I would go away from this place where I lived idly and at ease, back again to the wild land where I had spent my life, where I met my dear wife, and poor Harry was born, and so many things, good, bad, and indifferent, had happened to me. The thirst for the wilderness was on me. I could tolerate this place no more. I would go and die as I had lived, among the wild game and the savages. Yes, as I walked, I began to long to see the moonlight gleaming silvery white over the wide veldt and mysterious sea of bush, and watch the lines of game traveling down the ridges to the water. The ruling passion is strong in death, they say, and my heart was dead that night. But independently of my trouble, no man who has for 40 years lived the life I have can with impunity go coop himself in this prim English country, with its trim hedgerows and cultivated fields, its stiff, formal manners, and its well-dressed crowds. He begins to long, ah, how he longs, for the keen breath of the desert air. He dreams of the sight of Zulu impis breaking on their foes like surf upon the rocks, and his heart rises up in rebellion against the strict limits of the civilized life. Ah, this civilization, what does it all come to? For 40 years and more I lived among savages, and studied them and their ways. And now for several years I have lived here in England, and have in my own stupid manner done my best to learn the ways of the children of light. And what have I found? A great gulf fixed? No, only a very little one, that a plain man's thought may spring across. I say that as the savage is, so is the white man, only the latter is more inventive, and possesses the faculty of combination, save and except also that the savage, as I have known him, is to a large extent free from the greed of money, which eats like a cancer into the heart of the white man. It is a depressing conclusion, but in all essentials, the savage and the child of civilization are identical. I dare say that the highly civilized lady reading this will smile at an old fool of a hunter's simplicity when she thinks of her black bead-bedecked sister, and so will the superfine cultured idler scientifically eating a dinner at his club, the cost of which would keep a starving family for a week. And yet, my dear young lady, what are those pretty things round your own neck? They have a strong family resemblance, especially when you wear that very low dress, to the savage woman's beads. Your habit of turning round and round to the sound of horns and tom-toms, your fondness for pigments and powders, the way in which you love to subjugate yourself to the rich warrior who has captured you in marriage, and the quickness with which your taste in feathered headdresses varies. All these things suggest touches of kinship, and you remember that in the fundamental principles of your nature you are quite identical. As for you, sir, who also laugh, let some man come and strike you in the face whilst you are enjoying that marvelous-looking dish, and we shall soon see how much of the savage there is in you. There, I might go on forever, but what is the good? Civilization is only savagery, silver gilt. A vainglory, is it? And like a northern light, comes but to fade and leave the sky more dark. Out of the soil of barbarism it has grown like a tree, and, as I believe, into the soil like a tree it will once more, sooner or later, fall again, as the Egyptian civilization fell, as the Hellenic civilization fell, and as the Roman civilization, and many others, of which the world has now lost count, fell also. Do not let me, however, be understood as decrying our modern institutions, representing as they do the gathered experience of humanity applied for the good of all. Of course they have great advantages. Hospitals, for instance. But then, remember, we breed the sickly people who fill them. In a savage land they do not exist. Besides, the question will arise, how many of these blessings are due to Christianity, as distinct from civilization? And so the balance sways, and the story runs, here a gain, there a loss, and nature's great average struck across the two, whereof the sum total forms one of the factors in that mighty equation in which the result will equal the unknown quantity of her purpose. I make no apology for this digression, especially as this is an introduction which all young people and those who never like to think, and it is a bad habit, will naturally skip. It seems to me very desirable that we should sometimes try to understand the limitations of our nature, so that we may not be carried away by the pride of knowledge. Man's cleverness is almost indefinite, and stretches like an elastic band. But human nature is like an iron ring. You can go round and round it, you can polish it highly, you can even flatten it a little on one side, whereby you will make it bulge out the other. But you will never, while the world endures and man is man, increase its total circumference. It is the one fixed, unchangeable thing, fixed as the stars, more enduring than the mountains, as unalterable as the way of the eternal. Human nature is God's kaleidoscope, and the little bits of colored glass, which represent our passions, hopes, fears, joys, aspirations toward good and evil and what not, are turned in his mighty hand as surely and as certainly as it turns the stars, and continually fall into new patterns and combinations. But the composing elements remain the same. Nor will there be one more bit of colored glass, nor one less, forever and ever. This being so, supposing for the sake of argument we divide ourselves into 20 parts, 19 savage and 1 civilized, we must look to the 19 savage portions of our nature if we would really understand ourselves, and not to the 20th, which, though insignificant in reality, is spread all over the other 19, making them appear quite different from what they really are, as the blacking does a boot, or the veneer a table. It is on the 19 rough, serviceable, savage portions that we fall back on emergencies, not on the polished but unsubstantial 20th. Civilization should wipe away our tears, and yet we weep and cannot be comforted. Warfare is abhorrent to her, and yet we strike for the hearth and home, for honor and fair fame, and can glory in the blow, and so on through everything. So when the heart is stricken and the head is humbled in the dust, civilization fails us utterly. Back, back we creep and lay us like little children on the great breast of nature, she that perchance may soothe us and make us forget, or at least rid remembrance of its sting. Who has not in his great grief felt a longing to look upon the outward features of the universal mother, to lie on the mountains and watch the clouds drive across the sky, and hear the rollers break in thunder on the shore, to let his poor struggling life mingle for a while in her life, to feel the slow beat of her eternal heart, and to forget his woes, and let his identity be swallowed in the vast, imperceptibly moving energy of her of whom we are, from whom we came, and with whom we shall again be mingled, who gave us birth, and will in a day to come give us our burial also. And so in my trouble as I walked up and down the oak-paneled vestibule of my house there in Yorkshire, I longed once more to throw myself into the arms of nature. Not the nature which you know, the nature that waves in well-kept woods and smiles out in cornfields, but nature as she was in the day when creation was complete, undefiled as yet by any human sinks of sweltering humanity. I would go again where the wild game was, back to the land whereof none know the history, back to the savages whom I love, although some of them are almost as merciless as political economy. There, perhaps, I should be able to learn to think of my poor Harry lying in the churchyard without feeling as though my heart would break in two. And now there is an end of this egotistical talk, and there shall be no more of it. But if you whose eyes may perchance one day fall upon my written thoughts have got so far as this, I ask you to persevere, since what I have to tell you is not without its interest and has never been told before, nor will again. End of introduction.
The LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to find out how you can volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Allan Quatermain by H. Rider Haggard. Chapter 1. The Consul's Yarn. A week had passed since the funeral of my poor boy Harry, and one evening I was in my room, walking up and down and thinking, when there was a ring at the outer door. Going down the steps, I opened it myself, and in came my old friends, Sir Henry Curtis and Captain John Good, Royal Navy. They entered the vestibule and sat themselves down before the wide hearth, where, I remember, a particularly good fire of logs was burning. "It is very kind of you to come round," I said, by way of making a remark. "It must have been heavy walking in the snow." They said nothing, but Sir Henry slowly filled his pipe and lit it with a burning ember. As he leant forward to do so, the fire got hold of a gassy bit of pine and flared up brightly, throwing the whole scene into strong relief. And I thought, what a splendid-looking man he is! Calm, powerful face, clear-cut features, large gray eyes, yellow beard and hair. Altogether, a magnificent specimen of the higher type of humanity. Nor did his form belie his face. I have never seen wider shoulders or a deeper chest. Indeed, Sir Henry's girth is so great that, though he is 6 feet too high, he does not strike one as a tall man. As I looked at him, I could not help thinking what a curious contrast my little dried-up self presented to his grand face and form. Imagine to yourself a small, withered, yellow-faced man of 63, with thin hands, large brown eyes, a head of grizzled hair cut short and standing up like a half-worn scrubbing-brush, total weight in my clothes 9 stone 6, and you will get a very fair idea of Allan Quatermain, commonly called Hunter Quatermain, or by the natives Macumazahn. Anglic, character E. Grave, he who keeps a bright lookout at night, or in vulgar English, a sharp fellow who is not to be taken in. Then there was Good, who was not like either of us, being short, dark, stout, very stout, with twinkling black eyes, in one of which an eyeglass is everlastingly fixed. I say stout, but it is a mild term. I regret to state that of late years, Good has been running to fat in a most disgraceful way. Sir Henry tells him that it comes from idleness and overfeeding, and Good does not like it at all, though he cannot deny it. We sat for a while, and then I got a match and lit the lamp that stood ready on the table, for the half-light began to grow dreary, as it is apt to do when one has, a short week ago, buried the hope of one's life. Next, I opened a cupboard in the wainscoting and got a bottle of whiskey and some tumblers and water. I always like to do these things for myself. It is irritating to me to have somebody continually at my elbow, as though I were an 18-month-old baby. All this while, Curtis and Good had been silent, feeling, I suppose, that they had nothing to say that could do me any good, and content to give me the comfort of their presence and unspoken sympathy. For it was only their second visit since the funeral. And it is, by the way, from the presence of others that we really derive support in our dark hours of grief, and not from their talk, which often only serves to irritate us. Before a bad storm, the game always herd together, but they cease their calling. They sat and smoked and drank whiskey and water, and I stood by the fire also smoking and looking at them. At last I spoke. "Old friends," I said, "how long is it since we got back from Kukuanaland?"
3 years,
said Good. "Why do you ask?"
"I ask because I think that I have had a long enough spell of civilization. I am going back to the veldt."
Sir Henry laid his head back in his armchair and laughed one of his deep laughs. "How very odd," he said. "Eh, Good?" Good beamed at me mysteriously through his eyeglass and murmured, "Yes, odd, very odd."
"I don't quite understand," said I, looking from one to the other, for I dislike mysteries.
"Don't you, old fellow?" said Sir Henry. "Then I will explain. As Good and I were walking up here, we had a talk."
"If Good was there, you probably did," I put in sarcastically, for Good is a great hand at talking. "And what may it have been about?"
"What do you think?" asked Sir Henry.
I shook my head. It was not likely that I should know what Good might be talking about. He talks about so many things.
"Well, it was about a little plan that I have formed. Namely, that if you were willing, we should pack up our traps and go off to Africa on another expedition."
I fairly jumped at his words.
"You don't say so," I said. "Yes, I do, though, and so does Good. Don't you, Good?"
"Rather," said that gentleman.
"Listen, old fellow," went on Sir Henry with considerable animation of manner. "I'm tired of it, too. Dead tired of doing nothing more except play the squire in a country that is sick of squires. For a year or more I have been getting as restless as an old elephant who scents danger. I am always dreaming of Kukuanaland and Gagool and King Solomon's Mines. I can assure you that I have become the victim of an almost unaccountable craving. I am sick of shooting pheasants and partridges,
and want to have a go at some large game again."
"There, you know the feeling. When one has once tasted brandy and water, milk becomes insipid to the palate. That year we spent together up in Kukuanaland seems to me worth all the other years of my life put together. I dare say that I am a fool for my pains, but I can't help it. I long to go, and what is more, I mean to go." He paused and then went on again. "And after all, why should I not go? I have no wife or parent, no chick or child to keep me. If anything happens to me, the baronetcy will go to my brother George and his boy, as it would ultimately do in any case. I am of no importance to anyone."
"Ah," I said, "I thought you would come to that sooner or later. And now, Good, what is your reason for wanting to trek? Have you got one?"
"I have," said Good solemnly.
"I never do anything without a reason, and it isn't a lady. At least, if it is, it's several."
I looked at him again. Good is so overpoweringly frivolous.
"What is it?" I said.
"Well, if you really want to know, though I'd rather not speak of a delicate and strictly personal matter, I'll tell you. I'm getting too fat."
"Shut up, Good," said Sir Henry. "And now, Quatermain, tell us, where do you propose going to?"
I lit my pipe, which had gone out, before answering. "Have you people ever heard of Mount Kenya?" I asked.
"Don't know the place," said Good.
"Did you ever hear of the island of Lamu?" I asked again.
"No."
"Stop, though. Isn't it a place about 300 miles north of Zanzibar?"
"Yes."
"Now listen, what I have to propose is this, that we go to Lamu, and thence make our way about 250 miles inland to Mount Kenya. From Mount Kenya on inland to Mount Lekakisera, another 200 miles or thereabouts, beyond which no white man has, to the best of my belief, ever been. And then, if we get so far, right on into the unknown interior. What do you say to that, my hearties?" "It's a big order," said Sir Henry reflectively. "You are right," I answered, "it is. But I take it that we are all three of us in search of a big order. We want a change of scene, and we are likely to get one, a thorough change. All my life I have longed to visit those parts, and I mean to do it before I die. My poor boy's death has broken the last link between me and civilization, and I'm off to my native wilds. And now I'll tell you another thing, and that is that for years and years I have heard rumors of a great white race which is supposed to have its home somewhere up in this direction, and I have a mind to see if there is any truth in them. If you fellows like to come, well and good. If not, I'll go alone. I'm your man, though I don't believe in your white race," said Sir Henry Curtis, rising and placing his arm upon my shoulder.
"Ditto," remarked Good. "I'll go into training at once. By all means, let's go to Mount Kenya and the other place with an unpronounceable name and look for a white race that does not exist. It's all one to me."
"When do you propose to start?" asked Sir Henry.
"This day month," I answered, "by the British India steamboat. And don't you be so certain that things have no existence because you do not happen to have heard of them. Remember King Solomon's Mines." Some 14 weeks or so had passed since the date of this conversation, and this history goes on its way in very different surroundings. After much deliberation and inquiry, we came to the conclusion that our best starting point for Mount Kenya would be from the neighborhood of the mouth of the Tana River, and not from Mombasa, a place over 100 miles nearer Zanzibar. This conclusion we arrived at from information given to us by a German trader whom we met upon the steamer at Aden. I think that he was the dirtiest German I ever knew, but he was a good fellow and gave us a great deal of valuable information. "Lamu," said he, "you goes to Lamu, oh, ze beautiful place," and he turned up his fat face and beamed with mild rapture. "One year and a half I lived there and never changed my shirt, never at all." And so it came to pass that on arriving at the island we disembarked with all our goods and chattels, and, not knowing where to go, marched boldly up to the house of Her Majesty's Consul, where we were most honourably received. Lamu is a very curious place, but the things which stand out most clearly in my memory in connection with it are its exceeding dirtiness and its smells. These last are simply awful. Just below the consulate is the beach, or rather a mud bank that is called a beach. It is left quite bare at low tide and serves as a repository for all the filth, offal, and refuse of the town. Here it is, too, that the women come to bury coconuts in the mud, leaving them there till the outer husk is quite rotten, when they dig them up again and use the fibers to make mats with, and for various other purposes. As this process has been going on for generations, the condition of the shore can be better imagined than described. I have smelt many evil odors in the course of my life, but the concentrated essence of stench which arose from that beach at Lamu as we sat in the moonlit night, not under, but on our friend the consul's hospitable roof, and sniffed it, makes the remembrance of them very poor and faint. No wonder people get fever at Lamu. And yet the place was not without a certain quaintness and charm of its own, though possibly, indeed probably, it was one which would quickly pall. "Well, where are you gentlemen steering for?" asked our friend, the hospitable consul, as we smoked our pipes after dinner.
"We propose to go to Mount Kenya, and then on to Mount Lekakasira," answered Sir Henry. "Quatermain has got hold of some yarn about there being a white race up in the unknown territories beyond. The consul looked interested, and answered that he had heard something of that too. "What have you heard?" I asked. "Oh, not much. All I know about it is that a year or so ago I got a letter from Mackenzie, the Scotch missionary whose station, the Highlands, is placed at the highest navigable point of the Tana River, in which he said something about it."
"Have you the letter?" I asked.
"No, I destroyed it, but I remember that he said that a man had arrived at his station who declared that 2 months' journey beyond Mount Lukakasera, which no white man has yet visited, at least so far as I know, he found a lake called Laga, and that then he went off to the northeast a month's journey over desert and thorned veldt and great mountains, till he came to a country where the people are white and live in stone houses. Here he was hospitably entertained for a while, till at last the priests of the country set it about that he was a devil, and the people drove him away, and he journeyed for 8 months and reached Mackenzie's place, as I heard, dying. That's all I know, and if you ask me, I believe that it is a lie. But if you want to find out more about it, you had better go up the Tana to Mackenzie's place and ask him for information." Sir Henry and I looked at each other. Here was something tangible. "I think that we will go to Mackenzie's," I said. "Well," answered the consul, "that is your best way, but I warn you that you are likely to have a rough journey, for I hear that the Maasai are about, and as you know, they are not pleasant customers. Your best plan will be to choose a few picked men for personal servants and hunters, and to hire bearers from village to village. It will give you an infinity of trouble, but perhaps, on the whole, it will prove a cheaper and more advantageous course than engaging a caravan, and you will be less liable to desertion." Fortunately, there were at Lamu at this time a party of Wakwafi Askari, soldiers. The Wakwafi, who are a cross between the Maasai and the Wataveta, are a fine, manly race, possessing many of the good qualities of the Zulu, and a great capacity for civilization. They are also great hunters. As it happened, these particular men had recently been on a long trip with an Englishman named Judson, who had started from Mombasa, a port about 150 miles below Lamu, and journeyed right round Kilimanjaro, one of the highest known mountains in Africa. Poor fellow, he had died of fever when on his return journey, and within a day's march of Mombasa. It does seem hard that he should gone off thus, when within a few hours of safety, and after having survived so many perils. But so it was. His hunters buried him, and then came on to Lamu in a dhow. Our friend the consul suggested to us that we had better try and hire these men, and accordingly, on the following morning, we started to interview the party, accompanied by an interpreter. In due course, we found them in a mud hut on the outskirts of the town. Three of the men were sitting outside the hut, and fine, frank-looking fellows they were, having a more or less civilized appearance. To them we cautiously opened the object of our visit, at first with very scant success. They declared that they could not entertain any such idea, that they were worn and weary with long traveling, and that their hearts were sore at the loss of their master. They meant to go back to their homes and rest a while. This did not sound very promising, so by way of effecting a diversion, I asked where the remainder of them were. I was told there were six, and I saw but three. One of the men said they slept in the hut, and were yet resting after their labors. Sleep weighed down their eyelids, and sorrow made their hearts as lead. It was best to sleep, for with sleep came forgetfulness.
But the men should be awakened.
Presently they came out of the hut, yawning, the first two men being evidently of the same race and style as those already before us. But the appearance of the third and last nearly made me jump out of my skin. He was a very tall, broad man, quite 6'3", I should say, but gaunt, with lean, wiry-looking limbs. My first glance at him told me he was no Wakwafi, he was a pure-bred Zulu. He came out with his thin, aristocratic-looking hand placed before his face to hide a yawn, so I could only see that he was a Kishla, or ringed man, and that he had a great three-cornered hole in his forehead. End note. Among the Zulus, a man assumes the ring, which is made of a species of black gum twisted in with the hair, and polished a brilliant black. When he has reached a certain dignity and age, or is the husband of a sufficient number of wives, till he is in a position to wear a ring, he is looked on as a boy, though he may be 35 years of age, or even more. Allan Quatermain. In another second he removed his hand, revealing a powerful-looking Zulu face with a humorous mouth, a short woolly beard tinged with grey, and a pair of brown eyes keen as a hawk's. I knew my man at once, though I had not seen him for 12 years. "How do you do, Umslopogaas?" I said quietly in Zulu. The tall man, who among his own people was commonly known as the woodpecker, and also as the slaughterer, startled, and almost let the long-handled battle-axe he held in his hand fall in astonishment. Next second he had recognized me, and was saluting me in an outburst of sonorous language which made his companions, the Wakwafi, dare. "Kus, chief," he began, "kus I pageti, kus I umkul," chief from of old, mighty chief. "Kus, baba," father. "Macumazahn," old hunter, slayer of elephants, eater up of lions, clever one, watchful one, brave one, quick one, whose shot never misses, who strikes straight home, who grasps a hand and holds it to the death, i.e. is a true friend. "Kus, baba." Wise is the voice of our people that says, "Mountain never meets with mountain, but at daybreak, or at even, man shall meet again with man." "Behold, a messenger came up from Natal. Macumazahn is dead," cried he. "The land knows Macumazahn no more." That is years ago. "And now, behold, now in this strange place of stinks I find Macumazahn, my friend. There is no room for doubt. The brush of the old jackal has gone a little grey, but is not his eye as keen? And are not his teeth as sharp? Ha-ha, Macumazahn, mindest thou how thou didst plant the ball in the eye of the charging buffalo? Mindest thou?" I had let him run on thus because I saw that his enthusiasm was producing a marked effect upon the minds of the five Wakwafi, who appeared to understand something of his talk. But now I thought it time to put a stop to it, for there is nothing that I hate so much as this Zulu system of extravagant praising, bungering as they call it. "Silence," I said. "Has all thy noisy talk been stopped up since last I saw thee, that it breaks out thus and sweeps us away? What doest thou here with these men, thou whom I left a chief in Zululand? How is it that thou art far from thine own place, and gathered together with strangers?" Umslopogaas leaned himself against the head of his long battle-axe, which was nothing else but a pole-axe with a beautiful handle of rhinoceros horn, and his grim face grew sad. "My father," he answered, "I have a word to tell thee, but I cannot speak it before these low people, umfagozana. And he glanced at the Wakwafi Askari. It is for thine own ear. My father, this will I say. And here his face grew stern again. A woman betrayed me to the death and covered my name with shame. I, my own wife, a round-faced girl, betrayed me. But I escaped from death. I broke from the very hands of those who came to slay me. I struck but three blows with this mine axe in Kosikas. Surely my father will remember it. One to the right, one to the left, and one in front. And yet I left three men dead. And then I fled. And, as my father knows, even now that I am old, my feet are as the feet of the sasabi. End note. One of the fleetest of the African antelopes, Allan Quatermain. And there breathes not the man who, by running, can touch me again when once I have bounded from his side. On I sped, and after me came the messengers of death, and their voice was as the voice of dogs that hunt. From my own kraal I flew, and as I passed, she who had betrayed me was drawing water from the spring. I fleeted by her like the shadow of death, and as I went I smote with mine axe, and lo, her head fell. It fell into the water pan. Then I fled north. Day after day I journeyed on. For 3 moons I journeyed, resting not, stopping not, but running on towards forgetfulness, till I met the party of the white hunter, who is now dead, and am come hither with his servants. And naught have I brought with me. I, who was high-born, I of the blood of Chaka, the great king, a chief, and the captain of the regiment of the Nkoma Bakosi, am a wanderer in strange places, a man without a kraal. Naught have I brought save this mine axe. Of all my belongings, this remains alone. They have divided my cattle, they have taken my wives, and my children know my face no more. Yet with this axe, and he swung the formidable weapon round his head, making the air hiss as he clove it, will I cut another path to fortune. I have spoken. I shook my head at him. Umslopogaas, I said, I know thee from of old, ever ambitious, ever plotting to be great. I fear me that thou hast overreached thyself at last. Years ago, when thou wouldst have plotted against Cetewayo, son of Panda, I warned thee, and thou didst listen. But now, when I was not by thee to stay thy hand, thou hast dug a pit for thine own feet to fall in. Is it not so? But what is done is done. Who can make the dead tree green, or gaze again upon last year's light? Who can recall the spoken word, or bring back the spirit of the fallen? That which time swallows comes not up again. Let it be forgotten. And now, behold, Umslopogaas, I know thee for a great warrior and a brave man, faithful to the death. Even in Zululand, where all the men are brave, they call thee the slaughterer, and at night told stories round the fire of thy strength and deeds. Hear me now. Thou seest this great man, my friend, and I pointed to Sir Henry. He also is a warrior as great as thou, and strong as thou art, he could throw thee over his shoulder. Inkubu is his name. And thou seest this one also, him with the round stomach, the shining eye, and the pleasant face. Bugwan, glass eye, is his name. And a good man is he, and true, being of a curious tribe who pass their life upon the water and live in floating corrals. Now, we three whom thou seest would travel inland, past Dongo Egeri, the great white mountain, Mount Kenya, and far into the unknown beyond. We know not what we shall find there. We go to hunt and seek adventures and new places, being tired of sitting still with the same old things around us. Wilt thou come with us? To thee shall be given command of all our servants, but what shall befall thee, that I know not. Once before we three journeyed thus, in search of adventure, and we took with us a man such as thou, one Umbopa, and behold, we left him the king of a great country, with 20 impis, regiments, each of 3,000 plumed warriors, waiting on his word. How it shall go with thee, I know not. Mayhap death awaits thee and us. Wilt thou throw thyself to fortune and come? Or fearest thou, Umslopogaas? The great man smiled. Thou art not altogether right, Macumazahn, he said. I have plotted in my time, but it was not ambition that led me to my fall, but shame on me that I should have to say it, a fair woman's face.
Let it pass.
So we are going to see something like the old times again, Macumazahn, when we fought and hunted in Zululand. Aye, I will come. Come life, come death, what care I? So that the blows fall fast and the blood runs red. I grow old, and I have not fought enough. And yet am I a warrior among warriors. See my scars, and he pointed to countless cicatrices, stabs, and cuts that mark the skin of his chest and legs and arms. See the hole in my head, the brains gushed out therefrom. Yet did I slay him who smote, and live. Knowest thou how many men I have slain in fair hand-to-hand combat, Macumazahn? See, here is the tale of them, and he pointed to long rows of notches cut in the rhinoceros horn handle of his axe. Number them, Macumazahn, 103, and I have never counted but those whom I ripped open. End note. According to Zulu custom of opening the stomach of a dead foe, they have a superstition that if this is not done, as the body of their enemy swells up, so will the bodies of those who killed him swell up. Allan Quatermain. Nor have I reckoned those whom another man had struck. Be silent, I said, for I saw that he was getting the blood fever on him. Be silent. Well art thou called the slaughterer. We would not hear of thy deeds of blood. Remember, if thou comest with us, we fight not save in self-defense. Listen, we need servants. These men, and I pointed to the Wakwafi, who had retired a little way during our Indaba talk, say they will not come. Will not come! Shouted Umslopogaas. Where is the dog who says he will not come when my father orders? Here, thou! And with a single bound he sprang upon the Wakwafi, with whom I had first spoken, and seizing him by the arm, dragged him towards us. Thou dog, he said, giving the terrifying man a shake, didst thou say that thou wouldst not go with my father? Say it once more, and I will choke thee. And his long fingers closed round his throat as he said it. Thee and those with thee! Hast thou forgotten how I serve thy brother? Nay, we will come with the white man, gasped the man. White man, went on Umslopogaas in simulated fury, which a very little provocation would have made real enough. Of whom speakest thou, insolent dog? Nay, we will go with the great chief. So, said Umslopogaas in a quiet voice, as he suddenly released his hold, so that the man fell backward. "I thought you would."
"That man Umslopogaas seems to have a curious moral ascendancy over his companions," Good afterwards remarked thoughtfully. End of chapter 1.
LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to find out how you can volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Allan Quatermain by H. Rider Haggard. Chapter 2. The Black Hand. In due course we left Lamu, and 10 days afterwards we found ourselves at a spot called Chara, on the Tana River, having gone through many adventures which need not be recorded here. Amongst other things, we visited a ruined city, of which there are many on this coast, and which must once, to judge from their extent and the numerous remains of mosques and stone houses, have been very populous places. These ruined cities are immeasurably ancient, having, I believe, been places of wealth and importance as far back as the Old Testament times, when they were centers of trade with India and elsewhere. But their glory has departed now. The slave trade has finished them. And where wealthy merchants from all parts of the then civilized world stood and bargained in the crowded marketplaces, the lion holds his court at night. And instead of the chattering of slaves and the eager voices of the bidders, his awful note goes echoing down the ruined corridors. At this particular place, we discovered on a mound, covered up with rank growth and rubbish, two of the most beautiful stone doorways that it is possible to conceive. The carving on them was simply exquisite, and I only regret that we had no means of getting them away. No doubt they had once been the entrances to a palace, of which, however, no traces were now to be seen, though probably its ruins lay under the rising mound. Gone, quite gone, the way that everything must go. Like the nobles and the ladies who lived within their gates, these cities have had their day, and now they are as Babylon and Nineveh, and as London and Paris will one day be. Nothing may endure. That is the inexorable law. Men and women, empires and cities, thrones, principalities and powers, mountains, rivers, and unfathomed seas, worlds, spaces and universes, all have their day, and all must go. In this ruined and forgotten place, the moralist may behold a symbol of the universal destiny. For this system of ours allows no room for standing still. Nothing can loiter on the road and check the progress of things upwards toward life, or the rush of things downwards towards death. The stern policeman fate moves us and them on, uphill and downhill and across the level. There is no resting place for the weary feet, till at last the abyss swallows us, and from the shores of the transitory we are hurtled into the sea of the eternal. At Chara we had a violent quarrel with the headmen of the bearers we had hired to go as far as this, and who now wished to extort large extra payment from us. In the result he threatened to set them aside, about whom more anon, on to us. That night he, with all our hired bearers, ran away, stealing most of the goods which had been entrusted to them to carry. Luckily, however, they had not happened to steal our rifles, ammunition, and personal effects, not because of any delicacy of feeling on their part, but owing to the fact that they chanced to be in the charge of the 5 Wakwafis. After that, it was clear to us that we had had enough of caravans and of bearers. Indeed, we had not much left for a caravan to carry. And yet, how were we to get on? It was Good who solved the question. "Here is water," he said, pointing to the Tana River, and yesterday I saw a party of natives hunting hippopotami in canoes. I understand that Mr. Mackenzie's mission station is on the Tana River. Why not get into canoes and paddle up to it?" This brilliant suggestion was, needless to say, received with acclamation, and I instantly set to work to buy suitable canoes from the surrounding natives. I succeeded after a delay of 3 days in obtaining two large ones, each hollowed out of a single log of some light wood, and capable of holding 6 people and baggage. For these 2 canoes, we had to pay nearly all our remaining cloth, and also many other articles. On the day following our purchase of the 2 canoes, we effected a start. In the first canoe were Good, Sir Henry, and 3 of our Wakwafi followers. In the second, myself, Umslopogaas, and the other 2 Wakwafis. As our course lay upstream, we had to keep 4 paddles at work in each canoe, which meant that the whole lot of us, except Good, had to row away like galley slaves, and very exhausting work it was. I say, except Good, for, of course, the moment that Good got into a boat, his foot was on his native heath, and he took command of the party. And certainly he worked us. On shore, Good is a gentle, mild-mannered man, and given to jocosity. But, as we found to our cost, Good in a boat was a perfect demon. To begin with, he knew all about it, and we didn't. On all nautical subjects, from the torpedo fittings of a man of war down to the best way of handling the paddle of an African canoe, he was a perfect mine of information, which, to say the least of it, we were not. Also, his ideas of discipline were of the sternest, and in short, he came the Royal Naval Officer over us pretty considerably, and paid us out amply for all the chaff we were wont to treat him to on land. But on the other hand, I am bound to say that he managed the boats admirably. After the first day, Good succeeded, with the help of some cloth and a couple of poles, in rigging up a sail in each canoe, which lightened our labors not a little. But the current ran very strong against us, and at the best we were not able to make more than 20 miles a day. Our plan was to start at dawn, and paddle along till about 10:30, by which time the sun got too hot to allow of further exertion. Then we moored our canoes to the bank and ate our frugal meal, after which we ate, or otherwise amused ourselves, till about 3 o'clock, when we again started, and rode to within an hour of sundown, when we called a halt for the night. On landing in the evening, Good would set at once to work, with the help of the Iskari, to build a little skerm, or small enclosure, fenced with thorn bushes, and to light a fire. I, with Sir Henry and Umslopogaas, would go out to shoot something for the pot. Generally this was an easy task, for all sorts of game abounded on the banks of the Tana. One night Sir Henry shot a young cow giraffe, of which the marrow bones were excellent. On another I got a couple of waterbuck, right and left, and once, to his own intense satisfaction, Umslopogaas, who, like most Zulus, was a vile shot with a rifle, managed to kill a fine fat eland with a martini I had lent him. Sometimes we varied our food by shooting some guinea fowl or bush bustard, pau, both of which were numerous, with a shotgun, or by catching a supply of beautiful yellow fish, with which the waters of the Tana swarmed, and which form, I believe, one of the chief food supplies of the crocodiles. 3 days after our start, an ominous incident occurred. We were just drawing into the bank to make our camp as usual for the night, when we caught sight of a figure standing on a little knoll not 40 yards away, and intensely watching our approach. One glance was sufficient, although I was personally unacquainted with the tribe, to tell me that he was a Maasai Elmoran, or young warrior. Indeed, had I any doubts, they would have quickly been dispelled by the terrified ejaculation of "Masai" that burst simultaneously from the lips of our Wakwafi followers, who are, as I think I have said, themselves bastard Masai. And what a figure he presented as he stood there in his savage war gear! Accustomed as I have been to savages all my life, I do not think that I have ever before seen anything quite so ferocious or awe-inspiring. To begin with, the man was enormously tall, quite as tall as Umslopogaas, I should say, and beautifully, though somewhat slightly, shaped, but with the face of a devil. In his right hand he held a spear about 5.5 feet long, the blade being 2.5 feet in length by nearly 3 inches in width, and having an iron spike at the end of the handle that measured more than a foot. On his left arm was a large and well-made elliptical shield of buffalo hide, on which were painted strange heraldic-looking devices. On his shoulders was a huge cape of hawk's feathers, and round his neck was a naibere, or strip of cotton, about 17 feet long by 1.5 broad, with a stripe of color running down the middle of it. The tanned goatskin robe, which formed his ordinary attire in times of peace, was tied lightly round his waist, so as to serve the purpose of a belt, and through it were stuck, on the right and left sides respectively, his short pear-shaped sime, or sword, which is made of a single piece of steel, and carried in a wooden sheath, and an enormous knobkerrie. But perhaps the most remarkable feature of his attire consisted of a headdress of ostrich feathers, which was fixed on the chin and passed in front of the ears to the forehead, and being shaped like an ellipse completely framed the face, so that the diabolical countenance appeared to project from a sort of feather fire screen. Round the ankles he wore black fringes of hair, and projecting from the upper portions of the calves, to which they were attached, were long spurs like spikes, from which flowed down tufts of the beautiful black and waving hair of the Colobus monkey. Such was the elaborate array of the Masai Elmoran, who stood watching the approach of our two canoes. But it is one which, to be appreciated, must be seen. Only those who see it do not often live to describe it. Of course, I could not make out all these details of his full dress on the occasion of this my first introduction, being indeed amply taken up with the consideration of the general effect, but I had plenty of subsequent opportunities of becoming acquainted with the items that went to make it up. Whilst we were hesitating what to do, the Masai warrior drew himself up in a dignified fashion, shook his huge spear at us, and turning, vanished on the further side of the slope. "Halloa!" halloed Sir Henry from the other boat. "Our friend the caravan leader has been as good as his word, and set the Masai after us. Do you think it will be safe to go ashore?" I did not think it would be at all safe, but on the other hand we had no means of cooking in the canoes, and nothing that we could eat raw, so it was difficult to know what to do. At last Umslopogaas simplified matters by volunteering to go and reconnoitre, which he did, creeping off into the bush like a snake, while we hung off in the stream waiting for him. In half an hour he returned and told us that there was not a Masai to be seen anywhere about, but that he had discovered a spot where they had recently been encamped, and that from various indications he judged that they must have moved on an hour or so before, the man we saw having, no doubt, been left to report upon our movements. Thereupon we landed, and having posted a sentry, proceeded to cook and eat our evening meal. This done, we took the situation into our serious consideration. Of course, it was possible that the apparition of the Masai warrior had nothing to do with us, that he was merely one of a band bent upon some marauding and murdering expedition against another tribe. But when we recall the threat of the caravan leader, and reflected on the ominous way in which the warrior had shaken his spear at us, this did not appear very probable. On the contrary, what did seem probable was that the party was after us and awaiting a favorable opportunity to attack us. This being so, there were two things that we could do, one of which was to go on, and the other to go back. The latter idea was, however, rejected at once, it being obvious that we should encounter as many dangers in retreat as in advance, and besides, we had made up our minds to journey onwards at any price. Under these circumstances, however, we did not consider it safe to sleep ashore, so we got into our canoes, and paddling out into the middle of the stream, which was not very wide here, managed to anchor them by means of big stones fastened to ropes made of coconut fiber, of which there were several fathoms in each canoe. Here the mosquitoes nearly ate us up alive, and this, combined with anxiety as to our position, effectually prevented me from sleeping, as the others were doing, notwithstanding the attacks of the aforesaid Tana mosquitoes. And so I lay awake, smoking and reflecting on many things, but, being of a practical turn of mind, chiefly on how we were to give those Maasai villains the slip. It was a beautiful moonlit night, and notwithstanding the mosquitoes and the great risk we were running from fever from sleeping in such a spot, and forgetting that I had the cramp very badly in my right leg from squatting in a constrained position in the canoe, and that the Wakwafi, who was sleeping beside me, smelt horribly, I really began to enjoy myself. The moonbeams played upon the surface of the running water that speeded unceasingly past us towards the sea, like men's lives towards the grave, till it glittered like a wide sheet of silver, that is, in the open where the trees threw no shadows. Near the banks, however, it was very dark, and the night wind sighed sadly in the reeds. To our left, on the further side of the river, was a little sandy bay which was clear of trees, and here I could make out the forms of numerous antelopes advancing to the water, till suddenly there came an ominous roar, whereupon they all made off hurriedly. Then, after a pause, I caught sight of the massive form of His Majesty the Lion, coming down to drink his fill after meat. Presently he moved on. Then came a crashing of the reeds about 50 yards above us, and a few minutes later a huge black mass rose out of the water, about 20 yards from me, and snorted. It was the head of a hippopotamus. Down it went without a sound, only to rise again within 5 yards of where I sat. This was decidedly too near to be comfortable, more especially as the hippopotamus was evidently animated by intense curiosity to know what on earth our canoes were. He opened his great mouth, to yawn, I suppose, and gave me an excellent view of his ivories, and I could not help reflecting how easily he could crunch up our frail canoe with a single bite. Indeed, I had half a mind to give him a ball from my 8-bore, but on reflection determined to let him alone unless he actually charged the boat. Presently he sank again, as noiselessly as before, and I saw no more of him. Just then, on looking towards the bank on our right, I fancied that I caught sight of a dark figure flitting between the tree trunks. I have very keen sight, and I was almost sure that I saw something, but whether it was bird, beast, or man, I could not say. At the moment, however, a dark cloud passed over the moon, and I saw no more of it. Just then, too, although all the other sounds of the forest had ceased, a species of horned owl, with which I was well acquainted, began to hoot with great persistency. After that, save for the rustling of trees and reeds when the wind caught them, there was complete silence. But somehow, in the most unaccountable way, I had suddenly become nervous. There was no particular reason why I should be, beyond the ordinary reasons which surround the Central African traveller, and yet I undoubtedly was. If there is one thing more than another of which I have the most complete and entire scorn and disbelief, it is of presentiments. And yet here I was, all of a sudden filled with and possessed by a most undoubted presentiment of approaching evil. I would not give way to it, however, although I felt the cold perspiration stand out upon my forehead. I would not arouse the others. Worse and worse I grew. My pulse fluttered like a dying man's. My nerves thrilled with the horrible sense of impotent terror, which anybody who is subject to nightmare will be familiar with. But still, my will triumphed over my fears, and I lay quiet, for I was half sitting, half lying in the bow of the canoe, only turning my face so as to command a view of Umslopogaas and the two Wakwafi who were sleeping alongside of and beyond me. In the distance I heard a hippopotamus splash faintly. Then the owl hooted again in a kind of unnatural screaming note. End note. No doubt this owl was a wingless bird. I afterwards learnt that the hooting of an owl is a favourite signal among the Maasai tribes. Allan Quatermain. And the wind began to moan plaintively through the trees, making a heart-chilling music. Above was the black bosom of the cloud, and beneath me swept the black flood of the water, and I felt as though I and death were utterly alone between them. It was very desolate. Suddenly my blood seemed to freeze in my veins, and my heart to stand still. Was it fancy, or were we moving? I turned my eyes to look for the other canoe, which should be alongside of us. I could not see it, but instead I saw a lean and clutching black hand lifting itself above the gunwale of the little boat. Surely it was a nightmare. At the same instant a dim but devilish-looking face appeared to rise out of the water, and then came a lurch of the canoe, the quick flash of a knife, and an awful yell from the Wakwafi who was sleeping by my side, the same poor fellow whose odor had been annoying me, and something warm spurted into my face. In an instant the spell was broken. I knew that it was no nightmare, but that we were attacked by swimming Maasai. Snatching at the first weapon that came to hand, which happened to be Umslopogaas's battle-axe, I struck with all my force in the direction in which I had seen the flash of the knife. The blow fell upon a man's arm, and catching it against the thick wooden gunwale of the canoe, completely severed it from the body just above the wrist. As for its owner, he uttered no sound or cry. Like a ghost he came, and like a ghost he went, leaving behind him a bloody hand still gripping a great knife, or rather a short sword, that was buried in the heart of our poor servant. Instantly there arose a hubbub and confusion, and I fancied, rightly or wrongly, that I made out several dark heads gliding away towards the right-hand bank, whither we were rapidly drifting, for the rope by which we were moored had been severed with a knife. As soon as I had realized this fact, I also realized that the scheme had been to cut the boat loose, so that it should drift on to the right bank, as it would have done with the natural swing of the current, where no doubt a party of Maasai were waiting to dig their shovel-headed spears into us. Seizing one paddle myself, I told Umslopogaas to take another, for the remaining Askari was too frightened and bewildered to be of any use, and together we rowed vigorously out towards the middle of the stream, and not an instant too soon, for in another minute we should have been aground, and then there would have been an end of us. As soon as we were well out, we set to work to paddle the canoe upstream again to where the other was moored, and very hard and dangerous work it was in the dark, and with nothing but the notes of good stentorian shouts, which he kept firing off at intervals like a foghorn, to guide us. But at last we fetched up, and were thankful to find that they had not been molested at all. No doubt the owner of the same hand that severed our rope should have severed theirs also, but was led away from his purpose by an irresistible inclination to murder when he got the chance, which, while it cost us a man, and him his hand, undoubtedly saved all the rest of us from massacre. Had it not been for that ghastly apparition over the side of the boat, an apparition that I shall never forget till my dying hour, the canoe would undoubtedly have drifted ashore before I realized what had happened, and this history would never have been written by me. End of chapter 2. LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, and to find out how you can volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Allan Quatermain by H. Rider Haggard. Chapter 3. The Mission Station. We made the remains of our rope fast to the other canoe and sat waiting for the dawn and congratulating ourselves upon our merciful escape, which really seemed to result more from the special favor of Providence than from our own care or prowess. At last it came, and I have not often been more grateful to see the light, though so far as my canoe was concerned, it revealed a ghastly sight. There, in the bottom of the little boat, lay the unfortunate Askari, the sime or sword in his bosom, and the severed hand gripping the handle. I could not bear the sight, so hauling up the stone which had served as an anchor to the other canoe, we made it fast to the murdered man and dropped him overboard. And down he went to the bottom, leaving nothing but a train of bubbles behind him. Alas, when our time comes, most of us, like him, leave nothing but bubbles behind to show that we have been, and the bubbles soon burst. The hand of his murderer we threw into the stream, where it slowly sank. The sword, of which the handle was ivory, inlaid with gold, evidently Arab work, I kept and used as a hunting knife, and very useful it proved. Then, a man having been transferred to my canoe, we once more started on, in very low spirits and not feeling at all comfortable as to the future, but fondly hoping to arrive at the Highlands station by night. To make matters worse, within an hour of sunrise it came on to rain in torrents, wetting us to the skin, and even necessitating the occasional bailing of the canoes. And as the rain beat down the wind, we could not use the sails, and had to get along as best we could with our paddles. At 11 o'clock we halted on an open piece of ground on the left bank of the river, and the rain abating a little, managed to make a fire and catch and broil some fish. We did not dare to wander about to search for game. At 2 o'clock we got off again, taking a supply of broiled fish with us, and shortly afterwards the rain came on harder than ever. Also, the river began to get exceedingly difficult to navigate on account of the numerous rocks, reaches of shallow water, and the increased force of the current, so that it soon became clear to us that we should not reach the Reverend Mackenzie's hospitable roof that night, a prospect that did not tend to enliven us. Toil as we would, we could not make more than an average of a mile an hour, and at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, by which time we were all utterly worn out, we reckoned that we were still quite 10 miles below the station. This being so, we set to work to make the best arrangements we could for the night. After our recent experience, we simply did not dare to land, more especially as the banks of the Tana were clothed with dense bush that would have given cover to 5,000 Maasai, and at first I thought that we were going to have another night of it in the canoe. Fortunately, however, we espied a little rocky islet, no more than 15 miles or so square, situated nearly in the middle of the river. For this we paddled, and making fast the canoes, landed and made ourselves as comfortable as circumstances would permit, which was very uncomfortable indeed. As for the weather, it continued to be simply vile, the rain coming down in sheets till we were chilled to the marrow, and utterly preventing us from lighting a fire. There was, however, one consoling circumstance about this rain. Our askari declared that nothing would induce the Maasai to make an attack in it, as they intensely disliked moving about in the wet, perhaps, as Good suggested, because they hate the idea of washing. We ate some insipid and sodden cold fish, that is, with the exception of Umslopogaas, who, like most Zulus, cannot bear fish, and took a pull of brandy, of which we fortunately had a few bottles left, and then began what, with one exception, when we same three white men nearly perished of cold on the snow of Sheba's Breast in the course of our journey to Kukuanaland, was, I think, the most trying night I ever experienced. It seemed absolutely endless, and once or twice I feared that two of the askari would have died of the wet, cold, and exposure. Indeed, had it not been for timely doses of brandy, I am sure that they would have died, for no African people can stand much exposure, which first paralyzes and then kills them. I could see that even that iron old warrior, Umslopogaas, felt it keenly, though, in strange contrast to the Wakwafis, who groaned and bemoaned their fate unceasingly, he never uttered a single complaint. To make matters worse, about 1 in the morning we again heard the owl's ominous hooting, and had at once to prepare ourselves for another attack. Though if it had been attempted, I do not think that we could have offered a very effective resistance. But either the owl was a real one this time, or else the Maasai were themselves too miserable to think of offensive operations, which, indeed, they rarely, if ever, undertake in bush veldt. At any rate, we saw nothing of them. At last the dawn came gliding across the water, wrapped in wreaths of ghostly mist, and with the daylight the rain ceased, and then out came the glorious sun, sucking up the mists and warming the chill air. Benumbed and utterly exhausted, we dragged ourselves to our feet, and went and stood in the bright rays, and were thankful for them. I can quite understand how it is that primitive people become sun worshippers, especially if their conditions of life render them liable to exposure. In half an hour more, we were once again making fair progress with the help of a good wind. Our spirits had returned with the sunshine, and we were ready to laugh at difficulties and dangers that had been almost crushing on the previous day. And so we went on cheerily till about 11 o'clock. Just as we were thinking of halting, as usual, to rest and try to shoot something to eat, a sudden bend in the river brought us in sight of a substantial-looking European house with a veranda round it, splendidly situated upon a hill, and surrounded by a high stone wall with a ditch on the outer side. Right against and overshadowing the house was an enormous pine, the top of which we had seen through a glass for the last 2 days, but of course without knowing that it marked the site of the mission station. I was the first to see the house, and could not restrain myself from giving a hearty cheer, in which the others, including the natives, joined lustily. There was no thought of halting now. On we labored, for, unfortunately, though the house seemed quite near, it was still a long way off by river, until at last, by 1 o'clock, we found ourselves at the bottom of the slope on which the building stood. Running the canoes to the bank, we disembarked, and were just hauling them up on the shore when we perceived 3 figures, dressed in ordinary English-looking clothes, hurrying down through a grove of trees to meet us. "A gentleman, a lady, and a little girl," ejaculated Good, after surveying the trio through his eyeglass, "walking in a civilized fashion through a civilized garden to meet us in this place. Hang me if this isn't the most curious thing we have seen yet." Good was right. It certainly did seem odd and out of place, more like a scene out of a dream or an Italian opera than a real tangible fact. And the sense of unreality was not lessened when we heard ourselves addressed in good broad Scotch, which, however, I cannot reproduce. "How do you do, sirs?" said Mr. Mackenzie, a grey-haired, angular man, with a kindly face and red cheeks. "I hope I see you very well. My natives told me an hour ago they spied 2 canoes with white men in them coming up the river, so we have just come down to meet you." "And it is very glad that we are to see a white face again, let me tell you," put in the lady, a charming and refined-looking person. We took off our hats in acknowledgment and proceeded to introduce ourselves. "And now," said Mr. Mackenzie, "you must all be hungry and weary. So come on, gentlemen, come on, and right glad we are to see you. The last white who visited us was Alphonse. You will see Alphonse presently. And that was a year ago." Meanwhile, we had been walking up the slope of the hill, the lower portion of which was fenced off, sometimes with quince fences and sometimes with rough stone walls, into Kaffir gardens, just now full of crops of mealies, pumpkins, potatoes, etc. In the corners of these gardens were neat, mushroom-shaped huts, occupied by Mr. Mackenzie's mission natives, whose women and children came pouring out to meet us as we walked. Through the center of the gardens ran the roadway up which we were walking. It was bordered on each side by a line of orange trees, which, although they had only been planted 10 years, had in the lovely climate of the uplands below Mount Kenya, the base of which is about 5,000 feet above the coastline level, already grown to imposing proportions, and were positively laden with golden fruit. After a stiffish climb of 1/4 mile or so, for the hillside was steep, we came to a splendid quince fence, also covered with fruit, which enclosed, Mr. Mackenzie told us, a space of about 4 acres of ground that contained his private garden, house, church, and outbuildings, and indeed the whole hilltop. And what a garden it was! I have always loved a good garden, and I could have thrown up my hands for joy when I saw Mr. Mackenzie's. First, there were rows upon rows of standard European fruit trees, all grafted, for on top of this hill the climate was so temperate that nearly all the English vegetables, trees, and flowers flourished luxuriantly, even including several varieties of the apple, which generally runs to wood in a warm climate and obstinately refuses to fruit. Then there were strawberries and tomatoes, such tomatoes, and melons and cucumbers, and indeed every sort of vegetable and fruit. "Well, you have something like a garden," I said, overpowered with admiration, not untouched by envy. "Yes," answered the missionary, "it is a very good garden, and has well repaid my labor. But it is the climate that I have to thank. If you stick a peach stone into the ground, it will bear fruit the fourth year, and a rose cutting will bloom in a year. It is a lovely clime." Just then we came to a ditch about 10 feet wide, and full of water, on the other side of which was a loopholed stone wall 8 feet high, and with sharp flints plentifully set in mortar on the coping. "There," said Mackenzie, pointing to the ditch and wall, "this is my magnum opus, at least this and the church, which is the other side of the house. It took me and 20 natives 2 years to dig the ditch and build the wall, but I never felt safe till it was done, and now I can defy all the savages in Africa, for the spring that fills the ditch is inside the wall, and bubbles out at the top of the hill, winter and summer alike, and I always keep a store of 4 months' provisions in the house." Crossing over a plank and through a very narrow opening in the wall, we entered into what Mrs. Mackenzie called her domain, namely the flower garden, the beauty of which is really beyond my power to describe. I do not think I ever saw such roses, gardenias, or camellias, all reared from seeds or cuttings sent from England. And there was also a patch given up to a collection of bulbous roots, mostly collected by Miss Flossie, Mr. Mackenzie's little daughter, from the surrounding country, some of which were surpassingly beautiful. In the middle of this garden, and exactly opposite the veranda, a beautiful fountain of clear water bubbled up from the ground, and fell into a stonework basin which had been carefully built to receive it, whence the overflow found its way by means of a drain to the moat round the outer wall. This moat, in its turn, serving as a reservoir, whence an unfailing supply of water was available to irrigate all the gardens below. The house itself, a massively built single-storied building, was roofed with slabs of stone, and had a handsome veranda in front. It was built on three sides of a square, the fourth side being taken up by the kitchens, which stood separate from the house, a very good plan in a hot country. In the center of this square thus formed was, perhaps, the most remarkable object that we had yet seen in this charming place, and that was a single tree of the conifer tribe, varieties of which grow freely on the highlands of this part of Africa. This splendid tree, which Mr. Mackenzie informed us was a landmark for 50 miles round, and which we had ourselves seen for the last 40 miles of our journey, must have been nearly 300 feet in height, the trunk measuring about 16 feet in diameter at a yard from the ground. For some 70 feet it rose, a beautiful tapering brown pillar without a single branch, but at that height splendid dark green boughs, which looked at from below had the appearance of gigantic fern leaves, sprang out horizontally from the trunk, projecting right over the house and flower garden, to both of which they furnished a grateful proportion of shade, without, being so high up, offering any impediment to the passage of light and air. "What a beautiful tree!" exclaimed Sir Henry. "Yes, you are right, it is a beautiful tree. There is not another like it in all the country round that I know of," answered Mr. Mackenzie. "I call it my watchtower. As you see, I have a rope ladder fixed to the lowest bough, and if I want to see anything that is going on within 15 miles or so, all I have to do is run up it with a spyglass. But you must be hungry, and I am sure the dinner is cooked. Come in, my friends. It is but a rough place, but well enough for these savage parts. And I can tell you what, we have got a French cook." And he led the way onto the veranda. As I was following him, and wondering what on earth he could mean by this, there suddenly appeared, through the door that opened onto the veranda from the house, a dapper little man, dressed in a neat blue cotton suit, with shoes made of tanned hide, and remarkable for a bustling air and most enormous black mustachios, shaped into an upward curve and coming to a point for all the world like a pair of buffalo horns. "Madame bids for me to say that dinner is served. Monsieur, my compliments." Then suddenly perceiving Umslopogaas, who was loitering along after us and playing with his battle-axe, he threw up his hands in astonishment. "Ah, mais quel homme!" he ejaculated in French. "Quel sauvage affreux! Take but note of his huge chapers and the great pit in his head." "Ay," said Mr. Mackenzie, "what are you talking about, Alphonse?" "Talking about," replied the little Frenchman, his eyes still fixed upon Umslopogaas, whose general appearance seemed to fascinate him. "Why, I talk of him," and he rudely pointed, "of ce monsieur noir." At this everybody began to laugh, and Umslopogaas, perceiving that he was the object of remark, frowned ferociously, for he had a most lordly dislike of anything like a personal liberty. "Parbleu," said Alphonse, "he is angered, he makes the grimace. I like not his air. I vanish." And he did, with considerable rapidity. Mr. Mackenzie joined heartily in the shout of laughter which we indulged in. "He is a queer character, Alphonse," he said. "By and by I will tell you his history. In the meanwhile, let us try his cooking." "Might I ask," said Sir Henry, after we had eaten the most excellent dinner, "how you came to have a French cook in these wilds?" "Oh," answered Mrs. Mackenzie, "he arrived here of his own accord about a year ago, and asked to be taken into our service. He had got into some trouble in France, and fled to Zanzibar, where he found an application had been made by the French government for his extradition. Whereupon he rushed off up country, and fell in, when nearly starved, with our caravan of men, who were bringing us our annual supply of goods, and was brought on here. You should get him to tell you the story." When dinner was over, we lit our pipes, and Sir Henry proceeded to give our host a description of our journey up here, over which he looked very grave. "It is evident to me," he said, "that those rascally Masai are following you, and I am very thankful that you have reached this house in safety. I do not think that they will dare attack you here. It is unfortunate, though, that nearly all my men have gone down to the coast with ivory and goods. There are 200 of them in the caravan, and the consequence is that I have not more than 20 men available for defensive purposes in case they should attack us. But still, I will just give a few orders." And calling a black man, who was loitering about outside in the garden, he went to the window and addressed him in a Swahili dialect. The man listened, and then saluted and departed. "I am sure I devoutly hope that we shall bring no such calamity upon you," said I anxiously, when he had taken his seat again. "Rather than bring those bloodthirsty villains about your ears, we will move on and take our chance." "You will do nothing of the sort. If the Masai come, they come, and there is an end on it. And I think we can give them a pretty warm greeting. I would not show any man the door for all the Masai in the world." "That reminds me," I said. "The consul at Lamu told me that he had had a letter from you, in which you said that a man had arrived here who reported that he had come across a white people in the interior. Do you think that there was any truth in his story?" "I ask because I have once or twice in my life heard rumours from natives who have come down from the far north of the existence of such a race. Mr. Mackenzie, by way of answer, went out of the room and returned bringing with him a most curious sword. It was long, and all the blade, which was very thick and heavy, was to within a quarter of an inch of the cutting edge, worked into an ornamental pattern, exactly as we work soft wood with a fret saw. The steel, however, being invariably pierced in such a way as not to interfere with the strength of the sword. This in itself was sufficiently curious, but what was still more so was that all the edges of the hollow spaces cut through the substance of the blade were most beautifully inlaid with gold, which was, in some way that I cannot understand, welded on to the steel. End note. Since I saw the above, I have examined hundreds of these swords, but have never been able to discover how the gold plates were inlaid in the fretwork. The armourers who make them, and Zuvendis, bind themselves by oath not to reveal the secret. Allan Quatermain. "There," said Mr. Mackenzie, "did you ever see a sword like that?" We all examined it and shook our heads. "Well, I have got it to show you, because this is what the man who said he had seen the white people brought with him, and because it does more or less give an air of truth to what I should otherwise have set down as a lie. Look here, I will tell you all that I know about the matter, which is not much. One afternoon, just before sunset, I was sitting on the veranda when a poor, miserable, starved-looking man came limping up and squatted down before me. I asked him where he had come from and what he wanted, and thereon he plunged into a long, rambling narrative about how he belonged to a tribe far in the north, and how his tribe was destroyed by another tribe, and he, with a few other survivors, driven still further north, past a lake named Laga. Thence, it appears, he made his way to another lake that lay up in the mountains, a lake without a bottom, he called it. And here his wife and brother died of an infectious disease, probably smallpox, whereupon the people drove him out of their villages into the wilderness, where he wandered miserably over mountains for 10 days, after which he got into dense thorn forest, and was one day found there by some white men who were hunting, and who took him to a place where all the people were white and lived in stone houses. Here he remained a week shut up in a house, till one night a man with a white beard, whom he understood to be a medicine man, came and inspected him, after which he was led off and taken through the thorn forest to the confines of the wilderness, and given food and this sword, at least so he said, and turned loose. "Well," said Sir Henry, who had been listening with breathless interest, "and what did he do then?" "Oh, he seems, according to his account, to have gone through sufferings and hardships innumerable, and to have lived for weeks on roots and berries and such things as he could catch and kill. But somehow he did live, and at last, by slow degrees, made his way south and reached this place. What the details of his journey were I never learnt, for I told him to return on the morrow, bidding one of my headmen look after him for the night. The headman took him away, but the poor man had the itch so badly that the headman's wife would not have him in the hut for fear of catching it, so he was given a blanket and told to sleep outside. As it happened, we had a lion hanging about here just then, and most unhappily he winded this unfortunate wanderer, and springing on him, bit his head almost off without the people in the hut knowing anything about it, and there was an end of him and his story about the white people. And whether or no there is any truth in it is more than I can tell you. What do you think, Mr. Quatermain?" I shook my head and answered, "I don't know. There are so many queer things hidden away in the heart of this great continent that I should be sorry to assert that there was no truth in it. Anyhow, we mean to try and find out. We intend to journey to Lekakisera, and thence, if we live to get so far, to this Lake Laga. And if there are any white people beyond, we will do our best to find them." "You are a very venturesome people," said Mr. Mackenzie with a smile, and the subject dropped. End of chapter 3. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to find out how you can volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Allan Quatermain by H. Rider Haggard. Chapter 4. Alphonse and His Annette. After dinner, we thoroughly inspected all the outbuildings and grounds of the station, which I consider the most successful as well as the most beautiful place of the sort that I have seen in Africa. We then returned to the veranda, where we found Umslopogaas taking advantage of this favorable opportunity to clean all the rifles thoroughly. This was the only work that he ever did or was asked to do, for as a Zulu chief, it was beneath his dignity to work with his hands. But such as it was, he did it very well. It was a curious sight to see the great Zulu sitting there upon the floor, his battle-axe resting against the wall behind him, whilst his long, aristocratic-looking hands were busily employed, delicately and with the utmost care, cleaning the mechanism of the breech-loaders. He had a name for each gun. One, a double four-bore belonging to Sir Henry, was the Thunderer. Another, my 500 Express, which had a peculiarly sharp report, was the little one who spoke like a whip. The Winchester repeaters were the women who talked so fast you could not tell one word from another. The six martinis were the common people, and so on with them all. It was very curious to hear him addressing each gun as he cleaned it, as though it were an individual, and in a vein of the quaintest humor. He did the same with his battle axe, which he seemed to look upon as an intimate friend, and to which he would at times talk by the hour, going over all his old adventures with it, and dreadful enough some of them were. By a piece of grim humor, he had named this axe Inkosikaas, which is the Zulu word for chieftainess. For a long while I could not make out why he gave it such a name, and at last I asked him, when he informed me that the axe was very evidently feminine because of her womanly habit of prying very deep into things, and that she was clearly a chieftainess because all men fell down before her, struck dumb at the sight of her beauty and power. In the same way, he would consult Inkosikaas if in any dilemma, and when I asked him why he did so, he informed me it was because she must needs be wise, having looked into so many people's brains. I took up the axe and closely examined this formidable weapon. It was, as I have said, of the nature of a pole axe, the haft, made out of an enormous rhinoceros horn, was 3 feet 3 inches long, about an inch and a quarter thick, and with a knob at the end as large as a Maltese orange, left there to prevent the hand from slipping. This horn haft, though so massive, was as flexible as cane, and practically unbreakable, but to make assurance doubly sure, it was whipped round at intervals of a few inches with copper wire, all the parts where the hands grip being thus treated. Just above where the haft entered the head were scored a number of little nicks, each nick representing a man killed in battle with the weapon. The axe itself was made of the most beautiful steel, and apparently of European manufacture, though Umslopogaas did not know where it came from, having taken it from the hand of a chief he had killed in battle many years before. It was not very heavy, the head weighing 2.5 pounds, as nearly as I could judge. The cutting part was slightly concave in shape, not convex, as is generally the case with savage battle axes, and sharp as a razor, measuring 5 3/4 inches across the widest part. From the back of the axe sprang a stout spike 4 inches long, for the last 2 of which it was hollow and shaped like a leather punch, with an opening for anything forced into the hollow at the punch end to be pushed out above. In fact, in this respect, it exactly resembled a butcher's pole axe. It was with this punch end, as we afterwards discovered, that Umslopogaas usually struck when fighting, driving a neat round hole in his adversary's skull, and only using the broad cutting edge for a circular sweep, or sometimes in a melee. I think he considered the punch a neater and more sportsmanlike tool, and it was from his habit of pecking at his enemy with it that he got his name of woodpecker. Certainly in his hands it was a terribly efficient one. Such was Umslopogaas's axe, Inkosikaas, the most remarkable and fatal hand-to-hand weapon that I ever saw, and one which he cherished as much as his own life. It scarcely ever left his hand except when he was eating, and then he always sat with it under his leg. Just as I returned his axe to Umslopogaas, Miss Flossie came up and took me off to see her collection of flowers, African liliums, and blooming shrubs, some of which are very beautiful, many of the varieties being quite unknown to me, and also, I believe, to botanical science. I asked her if she had ever seen or heard of the Goya lily, which Central African explorers have told me they have occasionally met with, and whose wonderful loveliness has filled them with astonishment. This lily, which the natives say blooms only once in 10 years, flourishes in the most arid soil. Compared to the size of the bloom, the bulb is small, generally weighing about 4 pounds. As for the flower itself, which I afterwards saw under circumstances likely to impress its appearance fixedly in my mind, I know not how to describe its beauty and splendor, or the indescribable sweetness of its perfume. The flower, for it only has one bloom, rises from the crown of the bulb on a thick, fleshy, and flat-sided stem. The specimen that I saw measured 14 inches in diameter, and is somewhat trumpet-shaped, like the bloom of an ordinary longiflorum set vertically. First, there is the green sheath, which in its early stage is not unlike that of a water lily, but which, as the bloom opens, splits into 4 portions and curls back gracefully toward the stem. Then comes the bloom itself, a single dazzling arch of white enclosing another cup of richest velvety crimson, from the heart of which rises a golden-colored pistil. I have never seen anything to equal this bloom in beauty or fragrance, and as I believe it is but little known, I take the liberty to describe it at length. Looking at it for the first time, I well remember that I realized how, even in a flower, there dwells something of the majesty of its maker. To my great delight, Miss Flossie told me that she knew the flower well, and had tried to grow it in her garden, but without success, adding, however, that as it should be in bloom at this time of year, she thought that she could procure me a specimen. After that, I fell to asking her if she was not lonely up here, among all these savage people, and without any companions of her own age. "Lonely," she said. "Oh, indeed, no. I am as happy as the day is long. And besides, I have my own companions. Why, I should hate to be buried in a crowd of white girls all just like myself, so that nobody could tell the difference. Here," she said, giving her head a little toss, "I am I, and every native for miles around knows the water lily, for that is what they call me, and is ready to do what I want. But in the books that I have read about little girls in England, it is not like that. Everybody thinks them a trouble, and they have to do what their schoolmistress likes. Oh, it would break my heart to be put in a cage like that, and not to be free. Free as the air."
"Would you not like to learn?" I asked.
"So I do learn. Father teaches me Latin and French and arithmetic."
"Are you never afraid among all these wild men?"
"Afraid? Oh, no, they never interfere with me. I think they believe that I am Nagai of the divinity, because I am so white and have fair hair. And look here," and diving her little hand into the bodice of her dress, she produced a double-barrel nickel-plated derringer. "I always carry that loaded, and if anybody tried to touch me, I should shoot him. Once I shot a leopard that jumped upon my donkey as I was riding along. It frightened me very much, but I shot it in the ear, and it fell dead. And I have its skin upon my bed. Look there," she went on in an altered voice, touching me on the arm and pointing to some faraway object. "I said just now that I had companions. There is one of them." I looked, and for the first time there burst upon my sight the glory of Mount Kenya. Hitherto the mountain had always been hidden in mist, but now its radiant beauty was unveiled for many thousand feet, although the base was still wrapped in vapor, so that the lofty peak or pillar, towering nearly 20,000 feet into the sky, appeared to be a fairy vision, hanging between earth and heaven and based upon the clouds. The solemn majesty and beauty of this white peak are together beyond the power of my poor pen to describe. There it rose, straight and sheer, a glittering white glory, its crest piercing the very blue of heaven. As I gazed at it with that little girl, I felt my whole heart lifted up with an indescribable emotion, and for a moment great and wonderful thoughts seemed to break upon my mind, even as the arrows of the setting sun were breaking upon Kenya's snows. Mr. Mackenzie's natives call the mountain the Finger of God, and to me it did seem eloquent of immortal peace and of the pure high calm that surely lies above this fevered world. Somewhere I had heard a line of poetry, "A thing of beauty is a joy forever," and now it came into my mind, and for the first time I thoroughly understood what it meant. Base, indeed, would be the man who could look upon that mighty snow-wreathed pile, that white old tombstone of the years, and not feel his own utter insignificance. And, by whatever name he calls him, worship God in his heart. Such sights are like visions of the spirit. They throw wide the windows of the chamber of our small selfishness, and let in a breath of that air that rushes round the rolling spheres, and for a while illumine our darkness with a far-off gleam of the white light which beats upon the throne. Yes, such things of beauty are indeed a joy for ever, and I can well understand what little Flossie meant when she talked of Kenya as her companion. as Umslopogaas, savage old Zulu that he was, said when I pointed out to him the peak hanging in the glittering air. A man might look thereon for 1,000 years and yet be hungry to see. But he gave rather another colour to his poetical idea when he added in a sort of chant, and with a touch of that weird imagination for which the man was remarkable, that when he was dead, he should like his spirit to sit upon that snow-clad peak for ever, and to rush down the steep white sides in the breath of the whirlwind or on the flash of the lightning, and slay and slay and slay. "Slay what, you old bloodhound?" I asked. This rather puzzled him, but at length he answered, "The other shadows." "So thou wouldst continue thy murdering even after death?" I said. "I murder not," he answered hotly. "I kill in fair fight. Man is born to kill. He who kills not when his blood is hot is a woman and no man. The people who kill not are slaves. I say I kill in fair fight, and when I am in the shadow, as you white men say, I hope to go on killing in fair fight. May my shadow be accursed and chilled to the bone for ever, if it should fall to murdering like a bushman with his poisoned arrows." And he stalked away with much dignity and left me laughing. Just then the spies whom our host had sent out in the morning to find out if there were any traces of our Maasai friends about, returned and reported that the country had been scoured for 15 miles round without a single Elmoran being seen, and that they believed that those gentry had given up the pursuit and returned whence they came. Mr. Mackenzie gave a sigh of relief when he heard this, and so indeed did we, for we had quite enough of the Maasai to last us for some time. Indeed, the general opinion was that, finding we had reached the mission station in safety, they had, knowing its strength, given up the pursuit of us as a bad job. How ill-judged that view was, the sequel will show. After the spies had gone, and Mrs. Mackenzie and Flossie had retired for the night, Alphonse, the little Frenchman, came out, and Sir Henry, who is a very good French scholar, got him to tell us how he came to visit Central Africa, which he did in a most extraordinary lingo that, for the most part, I shall not attempt to reproduce. "My grandfather," he began, "was a soldier of the Guard, and served under Napoleon. He was in the retreat from Moscow, and lived for 10 days on his own leggings and a pair he stole from a comrade. He used to get drunk. He died drunk, and I remember playing at drums on his coffin. My father," here we suggested that he might skip his ancestry and come to the point. "Bien, monsieur," replied this comical little man with a polite bow. "I did only wish to demonstrate that the military principle is not hereditary. My grandfather was a splendid man, 6 feet 2 high, broad in proportion, a swallower of fire and gaiters. Also, he was remarkable for his mustache. To me there remains the mustache and nothing more. I am, monsieur, a cook, and I was born at Marseille. In that dear town I spent my happy youth. For years and years I washed the dishes at the Hotel Continental. Ah, those were golden days," and he sighed. "I am a Frenchman. Need I say, monsieur, that I admire beauty? Nay, I adore the fair. Monsieur, we admire all the roses in a garden, but we pluck one. I plucked one, and alas, monsieur, it pricked my finger. She was a chambermaid, her name Annette, her figure ravishing, her face an angel's, her heart, alas, monsieur, that I should have to own it, black and slippery as a patent leather boot. I loved to desperation. I adored her to despair. She transported me. In every sense, she inspired me. Never have I cooked as I cooked, for I had been promoted at the hotel, when Annette, my adored Annette, smiled on me. Never, and here his manly voice broke into a sob, never shall I cook so well again. Here he melted into tears. Come, cheer up, said Sir Henry in French, smacking him smartly on the back. There's no knowing what may happen, you know. To judge from your dinner today, I should say you are in a fair way to recovery. Alphonse stopped weeping and began to rub his back. Monsieur, he said, doubtless means to console, but his hand is heavy. To continue, we loved, and were happy in each other's love. The birds in their little nest could not be happier than Alphonse and his Annette. Then came the blow, sapristi, when I think of it. Monsieur will forgive me if I wipe away a tear. Mine was an evil number. I was drawn for the conscription. Fortune would be avenged on me for having won the heart of Annette. The evil moment came. I had to go. I tried to run away, but I was caught by brutal soldiers, and they banged me with the butt end of muskets till my mustachios curled with pain. I had a cousin, a linen draper, well-to-do, but very ugly. He had drawn a good number and sympathized when they thumped me. To thee, my cousin, I said, to thee, in whose veins flows the blue blood of our heroic grandparent, to thee I consign Annette. Watch over her whilst I hunt for glory in the bloody field. Make your mind easy, said he, I will. As the sequel shows, he did. I went. I lived in barracks on black soup. I am a refined man and a poet by nature, and I suffered tortures from the coarse horror of my surroundings. There was a drill sergeant, and he had a cane. Ah, that cane, how it curled! Alas, never can I forget it. One morning came the news. My battalion was ordered to Tonkin. The drill sergeant and the other coarse monsters rejoiced. I made inquiries about Tonkin. They were not satisfactory. In Tonkin are savage Chinese who rip you open. My artistic tastes, for I am also an artist, recoiled from the idea of being ripped open. The great man makes up his mind quickly. I made up my mind. I determined not to be ripped open. I deserted. I reached Marseille disguised as an old man. I went to the house of my cousin, he in whom runs my grandfather's heroic blood, and there sat Annette. It was the season of cherries. They took a double stalk. At each end was a cherry. My cousin put one into his mouth, Annette put the other in hers. Then they drew the stalks in till their eyes met. And alas, alas that I should have to say it, they kissed. The game was a pretty one, but it filled me with fury. The heroic blood of my grandfather boiled up in me. I rushed into the kitchen. I struck my cousin with the old man's crutch. He fell. I had slain him. Alas, I believe that I did slay him. Annette screamed. The gendarmes came. I fled. I reached the harbor. I hid aboard a vessel. The vessel put to sea. The captain found me and beat me. He took an opportunity. he posted a letter from a foreign port to the police. He did not put me ashore because I cooked so well. I cooked for him all the way to Zanzibar. When I asked for payment, he kicked me. The blood of my heroic grandfather boiled within me, and I shook my fist in his face and vowed to have my revenge. He kicked me again. At Zanzibar there was a telegram. I curse the man who invented telegraphs. Now I curse him again. I was to be arrested for desertion, for murder, and que sais-je? I escaped from the prison. I fled. I starved. I met the men of Monsieur Le Cure. They brought me here. I am full of woe. But I return not to France. Better to risk my life in these horrible places than to know the Banya. He paused, and we nearly choked with laughter, having to turn our faces away. "Ah, you weep, monsieur," he said. "No wonder. It is a sad story." "Perhaps," said Sir Henry, "the heroic blood of your grandparent will triumph after all. Perhaps you will still be great. At any rate, we shall see. And now I vote we go to bed. I am dead tired, and we had not much sleep on that confounded rock last night." And so we did, and very strange the tidy rooms and clean white sheets seemed to us after our recent experiences.